is the February 24th meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen. It's now 6 o'clock. Call the meeting to order. We're being videotaped by Frontier Community Access Television for viewing by our residents and the public later on. First item on our agenda is the minutes for the February 18th meeting. Has everybody had a chance to review the minutes?
Yeah, it looks fine, yep.
Any amendments or additions to them? No, we're all set?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the minutes for the meeting of February 18th. Do I have a second?
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Philip?
Yes, yes. I did say yes.
If he seconds it, I assume he says aye.
Okay, all right, well, good. Meeting is attended by select board members. Philip, what do we got?
The resumption with the establishment of the working group for the Union 38 contract negotiations has started. So those are not publicly posted meetings, so I don't think I have to comment on them any further.
That's good.
You're on the working group?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
I had no meetings.
And I also had meetings.
Well, it's a short week. We met Tuesday.
It was a short week, yeah, and it was, you know, tough week because all the kids are out of school.
Right.
There weren't many meetings to go to. Public comments. I don't see any of the public here, so we'll skip public comments. We don't have any old business, new business. Sign the warrant for the presidential primary election. Right. Okay. So I guess our clerk has provided us with this warrant. Has everybody seen a copy of this? Do you want to review it before we sign it?
So this is for the primary.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Okay, that's correct. And today is the 24th day.
It's coming up soon.
A week.
All right, so I'll make a motion that we approve the warrant for the presidential primaries. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
Okay.
So while we're signing, just for the viewing audience at home, early voting has started here in Conway, started today, and you can come down to Town Hall and see this ballot that we're sort of approving here.
Several votes were cast.
Including 12, mine. I voted early today.
12 people voted today.
Great. Awesome.
They don't have to
Okay, next item on our agenda is to sign the MEMA Emergency Management Planning Grant paperwork.
Which only you signed.
Okay. And that's this.
Yeah.
Okay.
And let me just...
Two copies? We have two copies of this.
No, just one. I'll just pass out the... this is the actual grant proposal. It's the two pages that make difference, just front and back. It was actually longer than that, but these were the two pages that, there's three.
This three.
Yeah. Just in case anybody's interested in looking at it, it's really simple, and it's basically a grant that if you sign up for it, you get it. And our highway superintendent, Ron Sweet, had so much good luck with the signboard, the electronic sign that he puts up, that he thought that one for each end of town, if there was something going on in town, would be appropriate, and our emergency management director agreed, and so he made this $2,500 for that,
sure.
And $200 for getting our medical supplies current. It's roughly a sixth of the cost of the sign, but it'll help because he's got some in the town budget, but this will help a lot. And then he also got a Maya grant for half of it. So.
Oh, great.
We're well on our way to having it funded.
Good. Okay. Any other questions, comments? Philip, how are you doing?
I will gladly sign this.
Okay. All right. So I'll make a motion that we sign the MEMA Emergency Management Planning Grant paperwork. Do I have a second?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Yeah.
Aye.
Next item on the agenda is to approve the request for the Frontier Regional High School excess and deficiency spending.
I thought we looked at this last week.
We don't have anything to sign for.
Yes.
Okay. Well, we did and approved it in principle. It was a new item, so I thought we should put it on the agenda and have a formal vote.
Formal vote. Okay. Any questions on that? We talked it over last week.
Yeah, we can also do nothing and it gets approved.
But that takes time.
You are right.
All right. So I'll make a motion that we approve the request for Frontier Regional High School excess and deficiency spending. Do I have a second?
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Just, you know, it is the policy, though, that half of their E&D gets given back to the towns to reduce assessments.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. That's standard. They've been doing that every year. Okay. Our next item is to appoint the town newsletter committee. That's Pat Lynch, Kathy Lamas, Louise Beckett, and Veronique Blanchard. That's for a term ending 6/30 of 2023.
So did we have business with them last week that was unfinished? They were in and talked about this last week.
Trying to remember.
Let's say unfinished, but the discussion, they remarked that they were a little bit stressed at with the responsibility of coming up with a budget number.
The next time they should be stepped.
And that they were kind of terrified of that, to actually do that. And they had hoped Pat would have been here because maybe that Pat would have had some budgetary comfort levels that they didn't.
We approved a max of
$5,000. Yeah.
Yeah. They were having trouble with the budget, so we said, "Okay, what's your outside number?" And that covered it. So we're you know, and they'll give us. It's their first time around on this, so you know they don't know what's going on in terms of budget.
I actually did some calculations and brought it down to $4,000.
Good.
Okay.
Good.
I think $3,900.
That's even better.
Great.
All right. Any other questions on approving these members of the committee?
Right, now, did we set up a date of service and all that, and the time of the committee that's
ending June 30th, 2023,
for all four?
I think it will start off with a 1-year appointment, and then if it actually is a going thing, we can make it into a standing committee and do staggered 3-year terms.
Because we don't really establish committees in even numbers either. It's always an odd number, right?
Yes. I mentioned that to Pat.
But this is like
she figured four people could do the work.
A newsletter committee.
Yeah. So if they ever get to any really, really tense editorial standoffs over, for instance, the use of the Oxford comma. The typo fails. That's all I'm saying.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. So I'll make a motion that we approve those four individuals. Do I have a second?
Yes.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is to appoint Mac McCoy to the Open Space Committee for term ending June 30th of 2023. He comes recommended by the Open Space Committee. So based on their recommendation, I'll make a motion that we approve him to be appointed to serve as a member of the Open Space Committee for a term ending of June 30th of 2020.
Second.
We have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Don't know. I like the alliterative name, though.
Oh, you do? Okay. Okay, now we have to consider the request from Conway Grammar School for the trust fund money for the playground. Tom, what do we have?
I thought that it would probably be a good idea to mimic what happened when we got a similar request from the Conway swimming pool, which was to request a number which represented the ADA compliance part of what they were looking for and use that as the number, because these two trust funds are for handicapped children. So I figure if we do just the same thing we did with the swimming pool, we'll be in good shape. We already have the recommendation from the lawyer that that's okay. So I thought we should ask them for, you know, a figure that represents the ADA compliance portion of that figure.
I think that's a good idea. That is a substantial part of what they're trying to redesign it for. In particular for the kids that are in wheelchairs to be able to be outdoors, and right now right now it's totally unsafe for the kids in wheelchairs.
How many children do we have in wheelchairs?
Every year at least two, sometimes up to four. And this year in particular, there's a kid with cerebral palsy that they really likes to go outside and sit outside, but they really can't do anything. So there's specific items that they wanted for that were sort of dual use for whatever, able body.
Do we know how much that is? You know, how much?
No, I think the request coming back from the board would be to give us a figure.
Okay,
to
great.
Generate a
yeah.
figure
yeah.
for
I think they have that information. I believe that the CPC committee is doing the hearing on Monday night next for them. At 6:30, so they were going to have the facilities. Billy Hildreth come, and a bunch of parents and whatever, and to discuss the bids that they got on the project and exactly what contains of it. The number that they're asking from CPA, $200,000, isn't going to come anywhere close to finishing the job. There's a bunch of active fundraising things that are going on too.
$200,000?
Yeah.
For the playground?
Yeah.
That's only part of it?
Yeah.
What's the total?
More.
Well, how much more?
It depends how much more they do.
This is for the playground.
The playground at the school.
At the school.
Yeah.
The little playground.
It's not so little. It's not so little. It's bigger than the one in the ball field.
It is?
Yeah, oh yeah.
And how much is that?
More than $200,000.
We'll find out.
That one was a substantial part of that ball field. Playgrounds are wicked expensive, and they're doing and of course it's the shredded tire, whatever is the base of it, because it's green and this and that. And but part of it too is just the high net. So the according to the district nurse, there's more injuries per year in the Conway playground than in the other three playgrounds combined.
Really?
Because it's become so unsafe just to fall from those things. The surface is so rock hard after all these years. It's
okay.
When you step on it, you see. So they've had two concussions this year, which
really,
which in and just in my kid's class, there was a broken arm, a broken wrist.
Really?
Yeah. Well, so it's because they have.
Well, who's supervising the children when they're?
Actually, we're the only school where the teachers themselves supervise the lunches. The other three schools, it's not a thing the teachers don't do, just the aides do. But we have teachers and aides out there, and they stagger the lunches so that they try to keep just a couple of classes out in recess at one time. Part of it is just the high injury thing in general. Part of it is just that it's old. It's
maybe we shouldn't have a playground.
Just have chores lined up for them all to do: washing, clothes folding.
What if we had a really serious injury on the playground?
I mean, those happen sometimes, but with a surface that's more forgiving when you hit it. But right now, the kids fall from 2 feet up off the ground and they get hurt.
Is it the same surface as in 1990?
It's wood chips.
I mean, the same one that we put in there originally?
It's wood chips that haven't been And the whole, it's a rock ledge underneath the wood chips. It's just not, that's just one part of it. But the things themselves are just all metal and hard and sharp and...
Are we brought them over from the old elementary school.
No, you're right. Are we going to have a much safer playground?
So they say. So they say.
Like nothing high up, so nobody can fall.
I think. Yeah, I guess so. I haven't dived deep into the specific plans because I just figure it's plans and.
We can show up on Monday.
That's on Monday at 6:30. I think they're planning.
So the money's going to come from CPA funds and trust funds. Anywhere else the money's coming from?
Fundraiser.
Yeah, fundraiser. So there's already a fundraising plan to generate at least $10,000 this school year.
All right, but if we're talking about $200,000 plus more money. So we have no idea what the final cost of this is going to be.
I know that if they did everything from the one end to the other end where the swing sets are closer to the road. Back to the garage. If they replace all that, that's another. I don't even think that's in the plan because that's another big six figures on top of everything. Because the asphalt itself, the asphalt that's part of the play area, I don't think that was planned. That's in the plan. So those are all wish lists, and if they can get more money, they will. But the decision for $200,000. Wasn't mine either. That was the administration's number. I think the estimates were up to three times that high.
Three times?
Yeah.
That's like a crazy number.
That's, playgrounds are crazy, what they cost to get done. And but this will do a lot. What they're asking for will do a lot. We'll take care of their urban stuff, in their opinion. But Deerfield just a couple years ago redid their playground with CPA money. Sunderland redid theirs with their CPA money, and those were each closer to $1 million. Deerfield's, I think they said, was almost $800,000. Sunderland's was even more than that.
All right, so we really don't have anything to really consider here since we don't have any real numbers.
No, we just have the email request. And I thought that a good response would be, give us a number for ADA compliance.
Right, okay. So we're basically, in principle, we will support this. Is that good?
Do we have enough money in the funds?
Oh, yeah, sure.
We do?
Okay. Yeah, we have enough money. In principle, we'll support it. We need numbers from them, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll make a motion that we'll support it in principle. Do I have a second?
Yes.
All in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
Okay.
And
come in.
McCoy.
Oh, man.
Have a seat. Okay. Thank you. Looks a little scary here.
No.
This is a scary group, man.
Okay.
Okay. Actually, we already appointed you, but please tell us about yourself.
From Virginia, moved here 12 years ago from D.C., bringing my daughter, who's now 25 and in Peace Corps Morocco, and son, who's now 23, and my wife, couldn't forget her, so we live on Newhall Road. Some people might know the Hart Farm, it's now the McCoy Farm, so to speak. Lovely spot, great view. Enjoyed being here, discovering all the beautiful clear streams and trails
and the sportsman's club right
and
down
the sportsman's clubs right up is actually great for running, which I enjoy going through there. But I import from India and Nepal, mainly Nepal, handcrafted gift and decorative items that I wholesale. Based in East Hampton Warehouse. What else do you want to know?
Right. Well, certainly we thank you for volunteering for the Open Space Committee.
That was a very lovely travelogue of our town that you just gave.
Oh, good, okay. Yes, I know, Janet's been after me for some time. I finally said, okay.
Yeah, it's tough to say no to Janet.
Well, eventually, I guess.
She wore you down.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's great. Do you have any questions of us?
No. Okay. I don't think so.
You'll get a letter telling you to come in and get sworn in by the town clerk.
Right.
And there's a state conflict of interest.
Right.
Instructional exam.
It's impossible to fail.
I did hear about it. I understand you do have to read it before you answer the question.
No, if you don't read it, they help you.
Yeah, they give you big hints.
Okay, that's better not to read it.
It's faster.
Okay. I understood about that, yes. So that comes by email or by paper?
We'll send that out probably tomorrow.
You can do that tomorrow.
I'll send it by mail. But you can come in and get sworn in whenever you, after tomorrow, because we'll give this to the town clerk, so she'll have it. So anytime after tomorrow, you can come in and get sworn in.
Okay, so just stop in at the office over there.
And then you get early vote this week, too.
I might do that. I heard Patrick Kennedy on the radio this morning. I was like, oh, listen to that. So that's 9 to 5 hours, roughly, the town clerk?
Tomorrow, early voting is 8 to 3, and so she'll be there
from
all
8
that
to
time.
3.
8 to 3.
Okay.
And then 8 to 5 on Wednesday, and 8 to 3 on Thursday, and 8 to 1 on Friday.
Okay. Well,
that, yeah, I know.
Anyway, is that it?
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. No, thank you.
Take care, Mac.
What was that, the name of the guy in Star Trek? What was his first name? McCoy.
Was he? Well, McCoy.
But he was McCoy, but he had a
first name. I was trying to think of that.
I was too.
That was Forrest.
Leonard?
Forrest somebody.
McCoy?
That was the name. That was the actor's name.
The actor's name. Yeah.
DeForest Kelly.
DeForest Kelly. You're right. You're right. Very good.
But what was the character's first name?
Yeah, McCoy.
Dan Rose.
All right. Later we'll talk about
this.
All right. Do we have any items not anticipated 48 hours in advance, Tom?
No.
Okay. Do you have your update, Thomas?
Yes, I do. All anybody ever calls me Bones.
That's right.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right. Bones.
Not too much. I've been spending most of my time on the budget, but in committee work, town council has advised the planning board that their proposed conditions for the cell tower project are fine and that we do not need the ZBA to issue variance.
Oh, good.
And departmental news, after conferring with Maya, I plan to get builder's risk coverage for the highway maintenance building. The contractor's liability coverage apparently only covers their actions, not the building itself. These policies are usually either purchased by the owner or provided by the contractor, and we did not ask contractors to provide it in our bid. And if we did, they would have charged us the cost of getting it plus the administrative cost of getting it. The Maya program was developed especially for cities and towns and has the town as the first named insured with the town controlling the policy. The other major reason to have our insurance company do it, it's cheaper and gives us more control.
Do we have trucks in the building now?
Yeah, that's the shed. This is for the maintenance building. If the project is completed early, we can get a partial premium return, straight prorated. The cost would be $35.58 per year with a $5,000 deductible. I plan to ask for 7 months, starting in May, or whenever they start construction, which would be prorated from that to $14.84. We have enough to cover the 2 months in this year's budget, May and June. So then I would add a certain amount for next year's. The project is supposed to be complete in 180 days or 6 months, but Maya needs the punch list and certificate of substantial completion before they'll add the building to our normal statement of values list. And another month at just under $300 seems worth it to be sure of a completed job in case of unexpected delays. Another Maya piece. I understand from Maya that our insurance will be going up substantially, mostly due to workers' comp claims being up substantially. Up 26%, that's our premium is up 26% for workers' comp. But also with some tornado damage figured in for property liability. It looks as though it will be about $3,200 more than I estimated on the previous Excel sheets that you've seen. Perhaps up as much as $10,218 rather than the $7,000 I estimated without access to real data. Last Wednesday, there was a mandatory pre-bid meeting for the highway maintenance building for both bidders and sub-bidders. About 8 general contractors attended and 10 subcontractors. This is a lot more interest than we got the last time. And there were few questions which made the design and bid documents were clear.
That's great.
Very good news about the pre-bid meeting.
Very good.
Yeah, so I do have some questions about the builder's risk, though. I mean, because I don't know a lot of things. I do know that when you call up the insurance salesman and ask if you need insurance, the answer is always yes.
I didn't even call him up. He said, hey, putting up a new highway garage, eh? You probably want builder's risk insurance. And we talked about that at the pre-bid meeting, actually, with one of the contractors. And we said, do you guys normally carry builder's risk, or does the town carry it? And he said, in the last 4 years of working, there have only been 2 cases in which the town did not carry builder's risk. And, you know, he said, well, you know, we just pass the cost on to you. And no doubt with an administrative fee attached. So we're going to pay for it one way or the other, and this gives us control. It's our insurance company. They're working for us. So that's...
The second sentence to me makes no sense. The coverage covers their actions, not the building itself. Well, it would be their actions that would endanger the building. So,
well, it could be a lightning strike. It could be anything. You know, fire.
Does the building committee have an opinion on the subject?
Well, not as such, but Walter was there when we were discussing it. Lon was there. And Hank was there, so they all heard and thought it would be a good idea.
They did?
Yeah. Well, again, we'll pay for it one way or the other. This way it's our insurance company, so they're working for us. And, you know, we could make an addendum to the contract. But that seems kind of clunky. That way you got 18 insurance companies with builder's risk in the overall scheme of things. So it's not that much money, which is good. And in order for Maya to insure it as a town building, it's in addition to what we already pay, because we pay according to the statement of values that we send in every year, that I send in every year. I give them all of the buildings. And this isn't on the list because it doesn't exist yet. So this is a way to insure the building before it's complete.
All right, Phil.
I don't know. Sounds like a lot for nothing. But I'll look into it.
Okay. All right, next item. Concerns of the select. Do we have any concerns? Concerns? Anybody? No? Okay. Mail. We don't have any mail.
Yeah, there is mail.
There is mail?
There's mail.
Hello, Tom, I didn't see mail.
Should we get the finance committee?
Here.
Yeah. Let's wonder what's this.
Tom? Is Is that this week?
Yep.
Okay, this is from the Frontier Regional and Union 38 School Districts. It's addressed to the board, and it says you are invited to attend a public hearing and meeting of the Conway Committee, Conway School Committee, to discuss the proposed fiscal 2021 budget at the Conway Grammar School on March 19th at 6 p.m. You're also...
You might actually repeat that for Alan, because I'm sure he would want to go as well.
Okay. Hello, Alan.
Hello. What's this, we're invited to a public hearing?
If only. We're invited to a public hearing of the Conway Grammar School School Committee, March 19th, 6 p.m. at the Grammar School, and a public hearing of the Frontier Regional School Committee to discuss the 2021 budget of the Frontier Regional School on March 3rd at 6 p.m.
Wow, March 3rd.
Yes, and that's at the Frontier School.
So what are we going to do? Just cancel next Monday's meeting?
Well, it's a Tuesday, right? March 3rd?
No.
March 3rd is a Tuesday.
Oh, it is a Tuesday. Oh,
March 1st is next Sunday.
It's voting day, Super Tuesday.
It's Super Tuesday.
So, and I had been like advising, letting you know when the first budget meeting was for each of those committees, when it was still tentative numbers, because I always thought the opportunity for input was more valuable then, because it's not a final product. By the time it gets to this stage, everything's pretty much fleshed out, and I think we were kind of there already. So,
I have a question. March 16th, I think we're going to be going over the final budget here for Conway Grammar and Frontier Regional Schools, correct?
Well, it won't be the final budget.
It's not final until the school committee's voted.
Oh, so it'll be the same information for the 19th presentation, do you think?
At this point, we think so.
All right. And will the school administrators be here for the 16th to present, or should we wait for the 19th to avoid what's
If they usually are, then they are. I think that's one of the things that we haven't, some years it's on, we do that, and some years we haven't.
Yeah.
But if their attendance is desired, they will definitely come.
Usually they do.
Yeah.
Well, I think it would be helpful for the businessman, at least usually the grammar school principal to be here.
When they come, we usually get a fair amount of information.
And then keep in mind that it's being televised to the town, too.
So the March 19th, is that at 6 o'clock?
Yes. Yeah. All right, so we have a joint meeting now with the Finance Committee to talk about the 2021 budget. Tom, what do we have on that?
A couple of things. If you'll open up the folding budget that says draft on top of it. This is by far the majority of the information you should be interested in. A couple of changes from the last one. And some caveats. Obviously, the school budgets are still not final figures, but they're pretty close because both the Conway Grammar School Committee and the Frontier Regional School Committee have voted them as preliminary budgets. Mm-hmm. So we know that that's at least what we're working from, so changes should be relatively minor. On Article 2, more on Article 2. The insurance figure may go up or down. I think...
Which number are we talking about?
That's 193. 193 is going up substantially, mostly due to workers' compensation claims, some tornado damage. I do not have figured in here yet about another $1,000 for a builder's risk insurance for the highway maintenance building as it goes up. So that will probably go up. This also includes an estimate for the property and casualty property liability going up because of the tornado, a little echo of the tornado in there. And so that's actually a low figure, but it's probably no more than, say, $1,500 low. So in the grand scheme, that's, you know, it'll bump things up a little, but not a huge amount.
So Tom, is that the general liability policy that's going up, or is that the workers' comp policy that's going up, or both? The
workman's comp.
Workman's comp is going up 26%.
Wow.
I don't know how much the property liability, general liability, is going up.
We had a bunch of claims this past year on workers' comp. Is that why we're being reassessed?
Yeah.
Right, that's always why it goes up.
Yeah.
And
you pay dollar for dollar back in the policy what your claims are.
And they've adjusted it for when you have claims.
So have we done any type of analysis of the claims to determine where they're coming from, and if there's anything that we can do to cut back on them?
I have just gotten a list of all the claims. So I can certainly look at those and see. I did include a 15% rise in general liability as a marker in that figure.
These are all within the 193 account?
Yeah, that's all within 193. So it
would be helpful to have them.
That 10,210 probably be up $1,000 anyway. And more or less depending on how much the general liability varies from the 15% I estimated. Still, the two biggest are the 900 figure and the 512 figure. That's a Board of Health for the recycling. 20,000 of that 25,000 is for the new recycling contract. And we've been over the 83,000 before. The 150 salary line, that's the town administration salary line, is up. 4,000 of that is from, it's also a tentative number. It's kind of a highest cost number. 4,000 of that is for taking on the administrative assistant to boards and committees under that line item. So those are all the items that are over $10,000.
What was the 900 one? The 900 budget?
That's the employee benefits. So of that, about three quarters of that is health benefits going up, and about a quarter is the pensions going up.
That includes the four additional people who are going to be taking health insurance, right?
Six.
Well, we budgeted two, but six are going to take, so it's an increase four above budget.
Right.
Right. Next year it'll be up six.
Yeah.
Because we were able to absorb two this year.
Okay.
So yep. Yeah. Nice.
And that's without any increase in the policy itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We were very lucky on that. Over in the top right-hand section, which is the money articles that have been proposed for the town meeting warrant, down, I have them in descending order of, except for the top two, I have them in descending order of cost. And the $25,000 figure is new. I'm proposing that we do give our usual contribution, which is really a replenishment this year, more or less, to the Conway Grammar School Capital Stabilization Fund. We have that money in general stabilization, and occasionally we have used that to supplement our capital stabilization fund. So rather than deplete the capital stabilization fund, since we have this other, well, first, we know that we're going to need more money in that than we have now. And we do have this other source of funding available, general stabilization. We were not expecting this expense. So I think it's reasonable to take it from general stabilization this year, which still has well over $200,000 in it. And so that's new. So that does bump up the total that we're asking for in the money articles. Down near the bottom, you can see in the in that one section, the total stabilization funds used, $173,500. And over in the bottom right, the total free cash used, $479,247. And that's out of the total of $497,050. That's what's left over after we spent about $80,000 at the special town meeting. So we started off with 570-something. We have just under $500,000 left over for the annual town meeting, of which pretty much all is spoken for. We only have $17,000 remaining, so we will not have the situation we had last year where we had a very healthy amount rolling over to the next year. This is where things can be seen as being a little tight in the budget. Mm-hmm. However, if you... going back to the Article 2, however, we're still not using raise and appropriate for any of the money articles. Mm-hmm. We're able to fund all of them through non-tax funding. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the very bottom line, where the totals are, the change in Article 2 in taxation, mm-hmm. it's up $217,000, which is a 3.48% rise at this point. Could rise to 3.5 with the insurance going up. Last year's rise was 3.08%. The year before that was 4.85%. So this is a lot closer to last year's really good, really low rise for what we've had in the past many years. So it's relatively good news. If you see the second box down on the right, the total town budget on one side, and a completely different chart. Don't try to match the lines on that chart with the non-tax revenue source over on the other side. But one shows spending, that's the total town budget, and the non-tax revenue source is non-tax revenue. And over in the bottom left of that center box, you can see the expenditures minus the non-tax revenue, leaving the balance to raise by taxes. If you compare that with the estimated levy limit for next year, that would give us an estimated $107,000 excess levy capacity, which is pretty healthy. We're not bumping up against our, what we could be taxing. And that's when some towns in the region like Shutesbury are up to, $24 per thousand, we're in good shape relative to that. So I also have down in the bottom center the town subtotal last year versus this year. Pretty much a flip from last year when the schools went up and the town didn't. This year the town's going up and the school isn't. The good news there is that when the town goes up, that's only 40% of the budget. When the school goes up, that's 60% of the budget.
Part of the town increase also is because of health insurance related to the schools.
If you look at, gentlemen, if you look at our increase in operating, if you look at line 193, mm-hmm. okay, that's an insurance hit for workers' comp, mm-hmm. all right? We have no control over that. If you look at item 900, that's a health insurance hit. We have no control over that. If you look at 512, that's an increase because of the recycling situation. So about $120,000 out of that $217,000 are items we have absolutely no control over. So our increase in items we have control over is actually about 1.5%. Okay. So, you know, I think we're doing really well on the operating side, and certainly on the capital items.
Yeah.
We have nothing that's coming out of raise and appropriate. Everything is coming out of stabilization and free cash, which is outstanding. So we're doing really well with this budget. As long as the schools come in the way we think they will, we're in good shape with this budget this year.
I have a quick question, Tom, regarding the expenditures for the items. This assumes that we will not get any grant money or settlement money from VW or other grants that you're considering applying for, right?
Right, right. We can't count on that. We can't build that as revenue into our budget.
Tom, under the town budget,
yeah.
Other than Article 2, what are the other things when it says money article, stabilization? Is that money we're transferring into the stabilization funds?
Or? No. We're transferring it into the general fund to spend it.
So, Bob, you see where that second line in money article, free cash, 479?
Yeah.
If you come over on the so top box, free cash yeah. used, go down to bottom.
Okay, so that's where that came from?
Yeah. That's all listed, all the stuff like the CPA, they're looking to spend 380 something thousand bucks. Right? That's all from above.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Tom, do you know if the division of
local services.
Yeah. They have, if one were to strip out schools and highway from the budget, okay, I don't know how, like, equipment, what I'm getting at is there a number they have cost of government per resident on a town-by-town basis?
That would be a
good, yeah.
You know, there's a number for that.
There's
they have
per
that
capita
number.
Spending, yeah. but they don't take in, and that would be for the total town budget.
Right, but see, that's misleading because maybe it's not. I mean, you've got towns on the Martha's Vineyard, on the Cape, where that kind of gets blown away. But if you look at just average towns in the Commonwealth, it would be helpful, I think, to our meeting, even to me, to know sort of where we stood there.
Yeah, it could be done. Actually, if you go to the next chart, you'll see that I have the four main categories that the Department of Revenue uses to calculate what's going up and what's going down for towns: general government, public safety, public work, and what they call it is health, education, and welfare. But for us, it's education, health, and veterans. Those are the only things. And council on agents in there too. So that this is mainly to show the difference. Well, first, the ratio between the spending on these things. General government, public safety, there are totals about a quarter of the way up the page for the four main categories that are outside of education. Then education is added in at the bottom and totaled up separately. So you can see the town plus the schools. But,
so the town, then that number, the 2.5 million plus or minus, does that become a useful number if you were to divide it by the number of residents in the town or the number of households? I mean, I don't.
Only if you want to feel how impoverished we are as a town and as a county.
Okay.
I mean,
that's a good answer.
I mean, because those numbers in the eastern side of the state are so. I was just in Acton the other day. That town is deciding whether to build the indoor swimming pool or the indoor street hockey rink.
Okay.
You know, and It's just...
That town also has more than 2,000 people there.
Yeah, right, but...
I mean, the thing down on the Cape is that the at least half the houses are taxed, and no one uses the school system, no one uses the services, other than maybe the cops in the summer because of the party.
Exactly.
But I mean, that's the basic difference of the Cape.
No, I think you'd have to exclude the towns east of 495, let's say.
In southern Berkshire, yeah.
But I heard that now we're up to like 1 in 4 or 1 in 5 houses that are second homes in our town.
Yeah.
So
I am more than happy to give anyone who wants it a tour through the Department of Local Services Municipal Data Bank and some of their...
Excellent information.
Related, all right, thank you. Related information that they have online, because there are things you can do yourself if they don't do... Mm-hmm. First, they do a lot. And secondly, you can do a lot yourself
with what they
with
give
the
you.
Tools yes. they give you.
Especially in the capital planning aspect, which they are really big on. Every time I go to
a lot of towns have professionals on staff to be able to write really nice stuff.
They also have good videos.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, new. Yeah. There's a whole new set of 5 and 10 minute videos about many aspects. I think I sent you the links for
that. Yes, you did.
Actually, and maybe you forwarded them on. I would recommend looking at least a few of those.
So I have a question. The new growth of 55,000 estimated, I mean, how realistic is that figure? And how,
which number are we talking about?
For estimated new growth in the bottom where it says the
levy number,
that section, excess capacity, we have an assumption of 55,000 increase of new growth.
That's very little.
If you will turn to the last page of your charts,
right.
You will see that on the third line. And I went over this with Lee. We had a long meeting last week, the administrative assessor and I, and we hashed out a whole lot of detail because I include this in the budget that I publish. And she thought, well, first, if you look at the 17, 18, 19 actuals, mm-hmm. We always project low. Yeah. So you can see we projected 2020 low. So she...
What are you looking at now?
It's this separate sheet. It's this one. It's this sheet.
Yeah, revenue summary.
In your packet.
Revenue summary is the top left side.
Look in the rest of your packet.
He's on the last page.
No.
Yeah,
he's got it in the last page. We have it as a separate sheet. It's in here somewhere.
Okay.
See it?
So new growth, we do project it low because the worst thing that a town can do is overestimate its revenue. If you have a revenue deficit, all the red lights at DOR go on.
How are we on track this year for actual versus projected for revenue growth?
We won't actually know that till later. I don't know where we are now, but we were just starting to get utility information.
Right.
We did get some very good news from Eversource. They have $2 million to declare new growth, which you know we chunked down to a couple tens of thousands, something like that, mm-hmm. for taxes.
Right.
But that was really, really good news. Not all of them are in yet. They're supposed to be in, and maybe they are, and I just haven't heard from Lee yet. But we try we try to underestimate that. That's again, FY18 was only 30,000, so it's really volatile.
Yeah.
And you want to be as sure as you can, and Lee was comfortable with that figure. The other thing is any gap between what you project and the actual comes back as free cash. So the lower you project, the more free cash you get.
Yeah.
That's one of the non-operating budget sources of free cash. So a lot of towns... really underestimate their new growth, and they have lots of money to play with.
Yeah.
But our budget is good, but it's not so good that we can't use that that free cash on our revenue side. As you see, we're only $100,000 excess levy capacity, and that's good, but it's not great. We were $300,000 not too long ago.
Right, and after this one, there's only $17,000 free cash.
And
yeah.
And are there ways to project what the free cash will be at the end of next year? Or
because any revenue projection is unreliable, and after about 5 years, with whatever method you're using, towns turn up in the red. With the exception of Conway, when Joe Markarian was working on a long-term plan for Conway, he said that we were the only town he knew that did not have a deficit after 5 years. Mm-hmm. Which is pretty amazing. On the other hand, the model he was using was a little difficult, and we're not using it now. But there is another one out there.
He's the man, though. I trust numbers from him.
He's good. Man.
Yeah.
Excellent. Yeah.
So in the in that figure, it was good, and he recognized that the town had good fundamentals.
So the new growth this year of 55,000, does that include anything for the cannabis cultivation business?
No.
Yeah.
Because they have publicly testified that just based on signed contracts and the amount that they are approved by the state, that it's 50,000 on the first year, based on the 1.5%, it's 50,000 to the town in the low end and 100,000 to the town on the high end, no pun intended.
Yeah.
That's for the first year.
And that would be an other source that would actually come in under under new growth.
That would be under what, cultivation? That would be a fee. It wouldn't be based on property tax and personal
and property, and that money is not
without strings, right? That's got to go to pay any added costs for their operation that the town incurs, and if stuff is left over, I'm not sure what you can do with that.
Right. No, we have a contractual agreement that is what our expenses are.
Right. Okay. And the RMV, the other source of the revenue, the RMV, ant livestock, and then the
excise tax.
The excise tax, but also the O tax, whatever.
Yeah, that's under table three. Yeah, table three here has local receipts.
That's tough, very tough.
So that has
that's always unpredictable.
The motor vehicle excise.
Right.
The only other one there that's anything really is licenses, permits, and fees.
Yeah. That's always unpredictable. Mm-hmm. I just made a note that it continues a trend we should all be concerned. We're all concerned about the watch is that the increase in the levy and appropriate portion of the budget as a percentage of year on year continues to exceed the new growth rate. From our real estate and personal property.
Yes, I did some research.
Last year we had some asset sales, which gave us some free cash, but we can't rely on that every year.
Right. I did some research and found that over the last 6 years, our property values rose an average of 1.5% per year. But for two of those years, property values actually went down. So
you mean in the state?
No, or in Conway.
In Conway?
In Conway. So it's very difficult, and you'll see, back to that first, the big spreadsheet. I don't have it on here anymore. I'm working on a separate tax rate sheet that's kind of scary, because you don't know what the property tax, what the property value is going to do from year to year.
Yeah.
And all you can do is say, well, if it's low, we'll have a higher tax rate, and if it's higher, we'll have a lower tax rate. And the spread that it gives you is within a dollar.
Yeah.
You know, so it's really playing dice. It's dicey.
I think our total real estate assessments are about $265 million, somewhere around there.
$269 million for fiscal year 2019.
So for every $275,000 or $65,000 we spend. That's a buck on the tax rate.
Yeah.
And right now we're talking about $217,654.
Yeah.
And of that, $110,000.
About $120,000 is uncontrollable.
And
insurance increases and the recycling contract.
It is three different things.
And $62,000 is from the schools. So that's $180,000 right there. So of what we can control, that's only like $40,000 that we have to play with.
Yeah, well, years ago I used to say to Joe Strigowski, you should just have the state come and run our town meeting. Because by the time the state's done, we argue about the nickels, dimes, and quarters.
Crumbs from the table. We get the crumbs from the table. You show the charter school going down to zero. Is that because we don't know, or?
That's what's in the governor's budget on our cherry sheet. That's what is projected in the governor's budget.
Zero.
For us, yes.
So they're giving us nothing for the kids that...
Well, if there are new kids who go in, we'll get something back. But there, you know, in terms of the budget as a whole, you're not talking a lot.
No.
In terms of reimbursement.
Does that money come to the town or to Frontier? I would expect it to go to Frontier.
Sometimes money comes back to the town, which is why it's on the town's cherry sheet. Yeah. Though I'll have to say, Chapter 70 is on the town's cherry sheet too, so I can't say whether it's direct or indirect. But it would be reflected in the school's budget.
Tom, on the big spreadsheet, is there no rumor? How come there's no that there's not the written which one's what? Which department, what budget, what number?
You're supposed to know that by now.
Could you add another column? Some cryptic?
Well, it used to be standard. Yeah. Most of the time it was standard.
Well, when it gets in the warrant, it has.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, this is my concise one. It used to fit, you know, on a vertically oriented piece of paper. So now that it's more of a horizontally oriented piece of paper, I can do that for you, yeah.
All right, thank you.
All right, well, it would be handy.
I have a question regarding these grants, you know, concerning the equipment for the highway department.
Yeah.
Is there an ultimate date by which we'll know if we have or not gotten these grants?
It will be after town meeting.
After town meeting, all right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Other questions? Okay. Thank you, Tom.
I should have something, I should have the larger document in maybe a week, but probably 2 weeks.
So by way of process, we have further town budget discussion scheduled for next Monday evening. And then March 9th, the 16th, rather, the school budget. So when would you want, when is the final? What are you, the warrants close, I think, any submissions close?
The 9th.
March 9th, yeah.
So long as I get final figures by the time the select board signs the warrant, I'm happy.
So in terms of us making final recommendations, I think anything prior to March 16th is premature, because we don't have a final school budget presentation until.
Yeah, you won't have the final from Conway at that point. You won't have the final, but I expect that the one we have now is going to be very close.
Okay.
And I expect the same for Frontier. I don't know, Phil, if you have any insight into whether, if there were changes, if there was any possibility of them going up.
Yeah, we actually, there was a few but line items where that is a possibility, but there's a greater, there's more line items where the possibility is that revenue would go up. Okay. So the greater, so it is possible that it could go up, but it's even more possible that it would go down if it moves at all. So,
good. Do you know, Phil, if for the March 16th presentation, will there be
projected student enrollments for Conway Grammar School, because at the preliminary presentation, there were no figures given.
Yeah, what I heard is that the numbers were looking surprisingly good for next year.
I mean, because there are always people at town meeting always ask what percent comes from choice, from in town, you know, all those fund trends and all that.
Yeah, the early pre-K numbers are sort of like a harbinger of the future, and those were higher than they have been in a few years, so.
Yes, understood. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Not for now.
But, you know, in going through this now, again, it strikes me that there could be closer coordination with the school dates for this and the town dates for this. The school puts their calendar together in May and June for the whole next year and votes on when all these budget meetings are going to be and everything. So
just don't look at the founding document for Frontier and see when they're supposed to get their budget.
Right, that's what happens. Yeah, that's what happens.
I think it's December.
Well, it'll be helpful, but I mean, we've had a lot of turnover in the budgeting position for Frontier Regional School and District 38 for the last 3 years.
Yeah, not. We got to keep her now, though. We got to.
Good.
Keep her.
Thank you, guys. Well, appreciate you coming in.
Sure.
Okay, next item on the agenda is our next meeting scheduled for Monday, March 2nd, here in the Town Hall at 6 p.m. We have a joint committee with Finance Committee at 6:30 p.m. All right, I'm going to make a motion that we go into executive session.
So just before I was wondering if next Monday we could do like a 15-minute break so I could go across the street at 6:30 for the CPC to testify before the CPC committee. They wanted parents to testify about their experiences with the dangerous playground.
Where's that going to be?
In the select board room.
Oh, over there. Yeah. Okay, yeah.
We'll make allowances.
So it's supposed to be 6:30 to 6:45 or something.
Okay,
so,
yeah,
that's good.
Okay.
So you guys, we may have you guys in at 6:45 next week.
6:45. All right. That's true. Gentlemen, I will make a motion that we go into executive session and we will, for reason one, conduct contract negotiations with the town administrator, and we will adjourn from the executive session. Roll call.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Dan.